35 days of a government shutdown with absolutely nothing achieved except a whole lot of pain inflicted on the American people. The lead starts right now. Breaking news. President Trump announces that the longest shutdown in this nation's history is over. Thousands of people, hundreds of thousands, were paid nothing because of it. And it looks like that's exactly what President Trump got out of this for now. Nothing. More huge breaking news. A major moment in the Russia probe. Longtime Trump ally Roger Stone dragged out of his house and into a courtroom today, and the indictment reads literally like a mob movie. He cut his teeth during Watergate, has an image of Richard Nixon tattooed on his back, and was once fired for having swinger fever. Can Roger Stone convince Robert Mueller that he is not a crook? We're taking a deeper dive into Stone's long and sleazy career.
This is CNN.
Deal to reopen the federal government after a 35-day shutdown, the longest in U.S. history. President Trump now says, hey, he's okay with a short-term deal, one that includes exactly $0 for his border wall, the reason for the shutdown. $0, which coincidentally is exactly equal to the last two paychecks for 800,000 federal workers, proving the government has been shut down now for 35 days for absolutely no reason. President Trump upended the process of funding the government to demand something that he never got. He inflicted pain on more than a million Americans for no reason, no result. Adding insult to injury, moments ago, Senator Schumer, the Democratic leader in the Senate, scolded President Trump for this long, unnecessary battle.
Hopefully now the president has learned his lesson. We cannot ever hold American workers hostage again.
CNN's Caitlin Collins joins me now live from the White House. Caitlin, this new government funding bill, it's only for 3 weeks. What happens? Bear with me now. What happens if it, at the end of this three-week period, the president still is not going to see any border wall money?
Well, Jake, according to what he told reporters in the Rose Garden today, either the government will shut down or he'll invoke a national emergency to bypass Congress to then fund and build his border wall. Now, today he faced the political reality that Democrats do not want to pay for the president's border wall. And now he's facing down the question of what he'll do in 3 weeks if they still haven't changed their minds.
I am very proud to announce today that we have reached a deal to end the shutdown and reopen the federal government.
President Trump backing off his 35-day standoff with Democrats today, announcing a deal to reopen the government temporarily.
In a short while, I will sign a bill to open our government for 3 weeks until February 15th.
The president's endorsement in the Rose Garden paving the way for Congress to pass spending bills that would reopen the government for 3 weeks. But the deal is seen as a cave to Democrats, who the president has failed to force to pay for his border wall once again.
I am asking Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell to put this proposal on the floor immediately.
Trump implying if he can't come to an agreement with Democrats in the next 3 weeks, he'll invoke a national emergency and bypass Congress.
If we don't get a fair deal from Congress, the government will either shut down on February 15th again, or I will use the powers afforded to me under the laws and the Constitution of the United States to address this emergency.
The short-term spending bill only includes $1.3 billion for border security and no new funding for the wall, making it a remarkable comedown for a president who declared for weeks he wouldn't waver, but today framed it as a win.
This is an opportunity for all parties to work together for the benefit of our whole beautiful, wonderful nation.
The presidential announcement coming after a White House official said air travel delays that rippled across the nation Friday played a major role in his decision, telling CNN this is getting worse and worse. He knows this has to end. And after members of the president's inner circle faced backlash for downplaying the financial hardship of the shutdown, Trump making a point to thank them today.
Many of you have suffered far greater than anyone but your families would know or understand.
Now, Jake, the longest government shutdown in history hasn't yielded anything for the president. He didn't get any money for his border wall. He's frustrated Republicans. He didn't do his base any favors by caving to the Democrats' demands today, and he even took a hit in the polls. Now, there are two things to watch over the next few days. That's whether or not the president tries to move forward with that initially scheduled State of the Union address on Tuesday, and two, how he responds to the overwhelmingly negative response from people who are in his conservative, hardline immigration base. Jake.
All right, Caitlin Collins at the White House. Thanks so much. Well, let's chat about this. Bill, I'll start with you. Did the president cave?
Sure, and he had to because he was losing support from Republican senators. McConnell held enough senators to prevent the Democratic bill from passing yesterday, but the Democrats got more votes than the Republicans, which doesn't usually happen in a 57-43 Republican Senate. And I think they had their regular lunch, or maybe it's not so regular on Thursday, of all the senators. It went 2 hours instead of the normal 1 or 2.5 hours, I think, perhaps, with real expressions of discontent and sort of this, I can't hold this anymore, not from, you know, Susan Collins and Lisa Murkowski, but from Senator Bozeman of Arkansas and all kinds of loyalists in the Republican conference who were getting phone calls from their state, from the workers, but also from businessmen, from agricultural interests, saying this is crazy, this cannot go on. So Trump caved to reality. You know, he only got this 3-week extension, which means that in 3 weeks, what happens in 3 weeks?
Well, he'll probably, my guess would be he invokes the national emergency.
Yeah. It's less than not getting anything. Like, he lost a lot here. Yeah. I mean, you think about it, in the 35 days, he lost $1.6 billion that he would have had if he agreed to the legislation that would have passed before the shutdown.
He lost for border security.
Right. And he lost a critical amount of leverage. Nancy Pelosi now knows exactly when he's willing, where he'll cave and what his pain points are. And then the other thing is, I think to Bill's point, which he's lost, one of the bigger problems going forward in the next 3 weeks, he may have lost the faith of some of his strongest supporters previously up on Capitol Hill. And that doesn't give him any sort of, you know, additional leverage going forward.
And Senator Turner, let me point to this, perhaps not coincidentally, this morning we saw some even more dire response, obviously for the 800,000 employees and the contractors. It's been awful. But this morning we saw mass flight delays. Mm-hmm. There was a stoppage at LaGuardia. The FBI director released a video slamming the shutdown. the Trump-appointed FBI director, at least 14,000 IRS workers just didn't go to work.
That's right.
And then it was the second day without a paycheck, the second paycheck period, a full month of no pay, for the 800,000 federal employees.
This is a hot mess. The president's a hot mess. You know, this is a hot mess. And more importantly, about which side won in terms of just the pure politics, you know, over 800,000 people, and that's not even counting the contract workers, have suffered through this for a president who got absolutely nothing. He brung the pain to all of these people, and he got nothing in return for this, and all they got is grief. And then also, we know, as big as the bureaucracy is, they're not going to recover from this tomorrow.
Right.
You know, if the president had any pride about himself, he would make sure that all of the people who are required to be there to process checks were there right now through the weekend, whatever it took to make sure that these workers got their money. But he really doesn't care. And that was shown by him. It was shown by people who work in his administration. Some even his family members weighed in on this. Mm-hmm. I think his daughter-in-law said, you know, it's okay. This is bigger than one person. It's that kind of, it's beyond cavalier. It's really sickening that the president would take the people impacted by this directly, and then to quote Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., what affects one directly affects us all indirectly.
Sure.
All of America was impacted
now,
by
you
this.
You can't live in Washington, D.C., which obviously has a lot of federal workers,
yes,
without hearing from cab drivers, Uber drivers, restaurateurs,
yes,
food truck owners, how awful things have been for the last months.
That's right.
And Jen, I want to get to a point that Kevin said that you brought up also yesterday, which is flashback a couple months. Nancy Pelosi, people are saying, is she even going to be elected Speaker of the House? There are enough Democrats that are wavering on her. 30-something Democrats said they weren't going to vote for her. Where is Nancy Pelosi now when it comes to the Democratic caucus?
Well, it's really remarkable. I mean, if you look at where we were in November, even after the Democrats won back the House, there was so much uncertainty that we were all talking about here about, you know, could she be elected Speaker? How would she fight off the moderates, et cetera? And now the wall and Trump's insistence on the wall has actually unified the Democratic Party. Pelosi's strength and kind of standing firm on this has unified the Democratic Party and the Democratic caucus at a time where it is very diverse with 40 new members. So that has been a real gift to her. And I would say, she's never been more powerful than she is today because of that. And if you look at what has happened over the past couple of days, even Trump supporters, sort of to Kevin's point, are questioning now whether she is actually running the government and not Trump. And that's not a place, that's not what is happening, but that's not a place you want your supporters and former staff to be. He looks weak, and that is something he always fights against.
Now, of course, there is this discussion that's going to go forward now about whether there will be sort of any border wall negotiation or any immigration reform, whatever. I don't know how it's going to happen, but Schumer talked about maybe a conference committee. We'll see. Listen to what President Trump said about what Democrats were telling him privately.
They have said they are for complete border security, and they have finally and fully acknowledged that having barriers, fencing, or walls, or whatever you want to call it, will be an important part of the solution.
I don't know what he's talking about.
Who knows? I come back to the Republican senators. I mean, this has hurt him in the polls. It's hurt him in the country, as it should have, in my opinion. But I just think when we say Trump insists on this, or Trump is able to, you know, fight back on that, it's because he has had the Republican Senate, now that they've lost the House, behind him. And I think that is now very precarious. McConnell held his people together at some cost to himself, when people wanted to bolt earlier. The senators kept voting loyally supported McConnell and refusing to bring anything to the floor for 4 weeks.
No, it's incredible.
And then voted yesterday, except for six.
Stick around. We're going to
stick with him. So, I mean, the degree to which going forward, he will not have the automatic support of the Senate Majority Leader or Republican senators, I think, can't be overestimated.
Yeah, we'll see. And stick around. We're going to keep talking about this. Did the Democratic leader of the Senate just double dog dare President Trump to declare a national emergency? Then also, there's another little story breaking today. FBI agents arresting President Trump's longtime friend and ally, Roger Stone, in an early morning raid. We have Stone's very clear message to President Trump after his release. Stay with us.
No one should ever underestimate the speaker, as Donald Trump has learned. Democrats stayed totally unified.
That was Senator Chuck Schumer, the Democratic leader of the Senate, just moments ago, touting the power of Speaker of the House Nancy Pelosi and her unified Democratic caucus. I want to go to CNN's Manu Raju on Capitol Hill. And Manu, you were at that news conference. Speaker Pelosi chose her words very carefully, but Schumer was the one saying President Trump needed to learn a lesson. Is it possible, however, that we're in for a repeat of the shutdown in 3 weeks when this new government funding bill runs out?
It's very possible, Jake. In fact, I tried to press the speaker at this press conference whether she'd be more open now to funding for the president's border wall. What was interesting is she did not explicitly say. She sort of sidestepped the question, said that this is going to be up to the discussions of the negotiators going forward. And she said to me, well, haven't I been clear about my position on the wall? And I said, well, what about right now over the next 3 weeks? And she would not say going forward, but still hard to see her coming to where the president wants and a deal that can be reached. That's why most people do expect we may end up in the same position we're on right now, Jake.
And Manu, does this mean that they're might be a new invitation for the president to deliver his State of the Union address in the House chamber? And if so, when?
That's a great question. We try to ask her that at this press conference and afterwards, and she would not say explicitly. In fact, the State of the Union, of course, was supposed to take place initially on Tuesday. That has been delayed during the shutdown. And when asked if Tuesday was still a date that the State of the Union would go forward, she said they were going to agree on a, quote, mutually agreeable date after the government is reopened. And so she would not say if it would happen Tuesday or when it happened afterwards. Reporters tried to press her about that after this press conference as well. She would not say. So another question going forward, perhaps, Jake, she wants to see the ink dry on the legislation to reopen the government before she goes forward and agrees to invite the president here to the House chamber. Jake.
Yeah, you want to wait for the document to be signed. I think that's fair. Manu Raju, thanks so much. Manu Raju on Capitol Hill. Let's continue our conversation. Senator Turner, take a look at this new poll. New Washington Post, ABC News poll shows whom Americans blame for the shutdown more. 53% say President Trump and Republican legislators. 34% say Speaker Pelosi and Democrats. 10% blame both. Now also take a look at the president's latest job approval number. 37% approval. I'm sorry to laugh, but that's just really low. 57% disapprove. It does seem like there was political pressure really starting to build on President Trump.
No, it was, Jake. And listen, he asked for it, and he got it. This is what he wanted. And sometimes you got to be careful what you ask for. He was very glib about, you know, I'll take ownership of the shutdown. It's mine. But the pressures that mounted, especially the human suffering, was more than, not necessarily for him, but more than the members of his Republican Party could stand at a certain point. So this is his shutdown. He owns it. And those polls are a clear reflection of how the American people felt about it. And this is going to be his eternal failure. And two, I wanted to make a point about something Bill said about Leader McConnell. He abdicated his responsibility. So did his entire caucus. And they put 800,000 plus people's lives in peril.
Well, while you're speaking, McConnell, take a listen to Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell just moments after President Trump's speech.
I've continuously said I wouldn't let the Senate become a theater for show votes and messaging stunts from either side. So I was glad to see today the president's announcement that he and our Democratic colleagues have reached an agreement that will immediately reopen the government.
Now, once again, just to remind people what happened 35 days ago or a little bit before, the Senate passed a bill, a clean government spending bill, clean. And then President Trump.
For the whole year.
For the whole year. And with the understanding that President Trump was going to sign it. And then Senate Republicans had the rug pulled out from under them by President Trump and the White House deciding they weren't going to sign it. But as Bill points out, Republicans were with him lockstep. Mm-hmm. Was that a mistake by Senate Republicans?
It was, but I think it also, what we don't see is what's happening behind closed doors. And I think behind closed doors, there is a high level of exasperation with the White House and the lack of a strategy here. And that it has increased a lot over the last 2 weeks. And I think Bill alluded to this earlier, that, you know, McConnell was pretty much at his wit's end with where the president was going there. I think McConnell was finished with trying to tell the president that this was the wrong approach and decided in the last probably 48 hours, 72 hours to show him that it was the wrong approach by putting these bills on the floors that couldn't get 60 votes. And that increased, a lot of the pressure. And you see, I think the policy luncheon, that the weekly policy luncheon that the senators on the Republican side had this week, there was a lot of raised voices. People were blaming Vice President Pence, trying to send the message to the White House about how this was a failed strategy.
I mean, if I were a vulnerable Republican in the Senate, of which there are many, I would be questioning if Mitch McConnell is the right person to be leading my caucus right now. He's up in 2020. I'm not going to say he's that vulnerable. It's Kentucky. But Kentucky loves Donald Trump. He wants to be aligned with Donald Trump. Is he thinking about the entire caucus or is he thinking about Mitch McConnell? He essentially disappeared for a month. He's the minority leader of the Senate. He's not a powerless actor.
Majority.
I'm sorry. Majority.
Your wish is kind of ahead of reality
there. He's the majority leader of the Senate. He's not a powerless actor. Yeah. And if you're Cory Gardner, if you're Susan Collins, I'd be questioning if he has your interests in mind.
Well, this is why we're not going to be back in 3 weeks where we are today or where we were 4 weeks ago. Because you now have a Republican conference that is not going to say, okay, let's just go back into another shutdown and that'll turn out great.
And it was
so I think Trump has no leverage.
Yeah.
And I think at best case for Republicans is he just passed what was passed, what the Senate passed 2 days before the shutdown began. And worst case is they make even more concessions.
All right, everyone stick around because we have another big story today. What Roger Stone's indictment reveals about the Russia investigation and the Trump campaign. That's next. Stay with us.
This is CNN, the most trusted name in news.
Welcome back. Sticking with politics, President Trump's longtime confidant and political advisor, Roger Stone, fighting charges filed by special counsel Robert Mueller today, alleging that Stone obstructed the Russia investigation, tampered with witnesses, and repeatedly lied under oath.
I will plead not guilty to these charges. I will defeat them in court. I believe this is a politically motivated investigation, but I have made it clear I will not testify against the president.
According to the 7-count indictment, Stone sought emails from WikiLeaks that could damage Hillary Clinton's candidacy, and this was done in coordination with Trump campaign officials. A reminder that Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, when he was CIA director, referred to WikiLeaks as a, quote, non-state hostile intelligence service, often abetted by state actors like Russia. No surprise, President Trump responded, as he almost always does on Twitter, quote, greatest witch hunt in the history of our country, no collusion. That's in all caps. CNN's Sarah Murray joins me now. Sarah, the indictment says that Roger Stone coordinated with the Trump campaign and tried to get stolen DNC emails from WikiLeaks.
That's right. It takes pains to outline Roger Stone's communications with Trump campaign officials who are not named in this indictment. But it also reveals a pattern of eagerness on behalf of the Trump campaign to try to get their hands on this damaging information that WikiLeaks had and to try to figure out when it was going to be coming out. Roger Stone reveling today in the post-arrest limelight after his initial appearance before a judge in Florida.
As I have always said, the only thing worse than being talked about is not being talked about.
But only after the pre-dawn raid, Stone hoped to avoid.
FBI, open the door.
FBI agents swarmed Stone's Fort Lauderdale home, arresting President Trump's longtime political advisor and friend, searching Stone's homes in Florida and New York.
They terrorized my wife, my dogs.
Hours later, Stone vowed to fight the charges against him.
I will plead not guilty to these charges. I will defeat them in court.
The indictment against Stone describes how he coordinated with senior Trump campaign officials to seek out stolen Democratic emails from WikiLeaks that could damage Hillary Clinton's campaign. And then he bragged about his contacts with WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange.
I actually have communicated with Assange.
According to the indictment, Stone spoke to senior Trump campaign officials about WikiLeaks and information it might have had that would be damaging to the Clinton campaign. Stone was contacted by senior Trump campaign officials to inquire about future releases by WikiLeaks. Prosecutors also allege a senior Trump campaign official was directed to contact Stone about any additional releases. It's unclear who delivered those instructions and which officials Stone was in touch with about WikiLeaks. At least one of them was Steve Bannon, the former White House chief strategist and chief executive of the Trump campaign. But Stone was not charged with conspiracy. He faces one count of obstruction and five counts of making false statements, both related to his alleged lies before the House Intelligence Committee.
Any error I made in my testimony would be both immaterial and without intent.
He also faces one count of trying to tamper with testimony from New York radio host Randy Credico, at one point even threatening to steal Credico's dog. Stone has claimed Credico was his back channel to WikiLeaks, which Credico denies. According to the indictment, Stone told Credico, "Stonewall it, plead the fifth, anything to save the plan," amid references to Richard Nixon and a character in the Godfather movies.
I never knew no Godfather.
A longtime political operative, Stone encouraged Trump to run for president and served as an advisor in the early months of Trump's presidential campaim. As the White House made this claim,
"This has nothing to do with the president and certainly nothing to do with the White House."
Today, Stone doubled down on his loyalty pledge.
"There is no circumstance whatsoever under which I will bear false witness against the president."
Now, in a court filing, the special counsel's office is giving us an indication of why this indictment was originally handed down under seal and also why they probably used such heavy-handed tactics in picking up Roger Stone this morning. It says they wanted this indictment under seal because they were concerned that Roger Stone may decide to flee or to destroy evidence. Now, Roger Stone has been under scrutiny for the better part of 2 years, so it's interesting if he decided to destroy evidence just last night. At any rate, he'll be appearing in D.C. in court on Tuesday for his arraignment, Jake.
All right, and Sarah Murray joins the panel of experts here. And Sarah, I just want to clarify something because there seems like a very important part of this. On page 4.12, after the WikiLeaks release of stolen DNC emails, a senior Trump campaign official was directed to contact Stone about any additional releases and what other damaging information WikiLeaks had on Hillary Clinton. Do we have any idea who the senior Trump official was that directed a different senior Trump campaign official? Because presumably you can only be directed if you are also senior.
Right. We don't know the answer to that. I mean, we know that Steve Bannon was one of the people that Roger Stone is in touch with in the Trump campaign, but that's basically all we know. And that tells you that there were multiple senior campaign officials who were involved in this conversation about trying to get this information they believed Roger Stone had about WikiLeaks. I think the obvious question is, was this then candidate Trump who was making this direction? We don't have an answer to that question yet, Jim.
Yeah, and just this was July 22nd. Bannon hadn't joined the campaign yet,
yeah.
So this would be when Manafort
was in the campaign.
So this would have been
a senior Trump campaign official who contacted Stone, and then another senior Trump campaign official who made that direction.
Who made the direction, yeah. And it's important whether it was Manafort telling Rick Gates to do it, mm-hmm. or whether somebody else was telling Manafort to do it. Kim Whaley, let me bring you in, because the Trump campaign's all over this, despite what Sarah Sanders says. I mean, the president is not referenced, but the Trump campaign is all over it. Is this conspiracy? Is this quote unquote collusion?
Well, collusion is a non-legal term. Conspiracy is a legal term.
Right.
I think the point was made that the charging it does not include conspiracy.
Yeah.
Here. That requires a meeting of the minds in addition to a step towards some kind of crime. But here we do have, as you mentioned, throughout this indictment, references to Trump and the campaign and Mr. Stone being the intermediary, basically communicating in a really brazen way about these leaks of damaging information from the Clinton campaign. And I think what people need to keep in mind here is why this matters. This matters because it could have affected the actual outcome of the election. Our democratic process could have been distorted by virtue of these leaks and the stolen emails, which is also a crime.
Of course, President Trump mentioned WikiLeaks all the time. I want to get your take on something, Jen Psaki, because you used to speak from the podium on behalf of the Obama campaign. Take a listen to this exchange between John Berman on CNN's New Day and Sarah Sanders, the White House press secretary, trying to get to the bottom of whether or not President Trump was the one who directed anybody to talk to Stone. Mm-hmm.
Did the president direct someone to contact Roger Stone about stolen emails?
Look, John, I'm not an attorney. I haven't read through that. Even if I had, I'm not going to be able to provide you some type of insider legal analysis. What I can tell you is that the specific charges that have been brought against Mr. Stone don't have anything to do with the president.
Well, do you know whether that individual was the president?
Look, I know that the charges are about whether or not he gave false statements.
Did the president know or not? Was it the president who made that direction or not?
Once again, I haven't read this document.
Okay. I mean, it would seem like before the interview, you would settle as to whether or not the president was the one that directed the campaign, senior campaign official, to reach out to Roger Stone.
Since that would be the most obvious question you would be asked. I mean, watching that one, it's very painful to watch, even though I'm not a Trump supporter, obviously. That would have been what you would have prepped. You could have decided you were going to cancel the interview. You could have been criticized for that. But what she did there is she made it seem like maybe he did know, maybe he was the person who directed it. And that actually did more damage than it did clean anything up. And that's never where you want to be as the spokesperson after an interview.
And presumably you would have read the indictment before coming on the...
Presumably you would have read the indictment, certainly before coming out to do an interview. But you also would have decided whether it was a wise thing to do an interview at all.
I want you to take a listen to what Roger Stone had to say today, Bill.
There is no circumstance whatsoever under which I will bear false witness against the president. I am one of his oldest friends. I am a fervent supporter of the president. I think he is doing a great job of making America great again.
There's nothing in this indictment that suggests that President Trump talked to Roger Stone at all. But there is stuff about people on the campaign. So he doesn't have to testify against President Trump.
Right. It's interesting that occurred to him that he might have to, which does raise the question of whether it wasn't the president who directed the senior official to deal with WikiLeaks or that the president would have known about such a direction. I do want to say something on the last panel. I said incorrectly that the Senate had voted in December to keep the government open through the whole fiscal year. It was just through February 8th. Right. So just to clarify that.
Thank you for the correction.
Yeah. But no, I think as of now, let me put it this way, because of what Sarah Sanders said, as of now, the White House is not denied, I believe, that the president might be the person at whose direction the senior campaign official dealt with WikiLeaks. That remains an open question. He could deny it now, or Sarah Sanders could deny it now. She could walk in and ask the president, and the president could say, no, it wasn't me, and then they could deny it. And I had no knowledge of it. But as of now, that has not been denied.
I think that we've been told that Manafort was not the one that reached out to Stone.
So we've gotten a lot of denials from a lot of people, but I'm running back through some of these denials in my head, and I know that Roger Stone has denied that he ever discussed WikiLeaks with Donald Trump, President Trump, candidate Trump. I also know that, you know, Trump's folks, his legal team, have said that he never discussed WikiLeaks with Roger Stone. We haven't ever gotten the denial that there was a conversation through an intermediary, perhaps, about WikiLeaks. We still didn't get that denial today, obviously, from Sarah Sanders. But as I'm racking my brain for previous denials, I can't remember that one, ruling that out either.
Yeah, Kim, as an experienced prosecutor, is Mueller's not done, do you think?
Oh, no. I think one thing that this demonstrates is that the notion that the whole thing will wrap up in the next month is kind of folly. I think there's a lot here. As was mentioned, we just see the tip of the iceberg. There's what's really interesting about this is there's a lot of documentary evidence, texts and emails from Mr. Stone in this indictment. I encourage people to actually read the actual indictment.
It's fascinating.
But no, this is going to go on.
and also all the denials from Stone. Sarah, President Trump tweeted today, greatest witch hunt in the history of our country, no collusion, blah, 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 blah. Who alerted CNN to be there? That's a reference to the fact that CNN had this great exclusive video this morning. To be clear, CNN was not alerted to be there. It was through reporting that it was there was a hunch. Tell us more.
Yeah, I mean, we did have a hunch. We heard that the grand jury was going to be meeting on Thursday, and that struck us as unusual. And they did, actually. They heard testimony from Jerome Corsi's stepson on Thursday, and we heard through our sources that there was a reason that it was scheduled for Thursday. There was some suggestion that they might be busy. Mueller's team might be busy on Friday. And, you know, we have a couple of our eagle-eyed reporters who spotted one of the prosecutors who has been working on this Roger Stone case, leave the office with a suitcase. And
a
so
suitcase. Where are you going?
You know, it just didn't seem like the right time for a prosecutor on the Roger Stone case to be taking a fun weekend away. And so we decided that out of an abundance of caution, you know, we should stake out Roger Stone's home just in case something did happen. And Stone and his attorney, I think, were very convinced that he would have an opportunity to turn himself in, that they would not get this kind of treatment from the FBI. But we, you know, followed what was unusual court activity, unusual prosecutor activity.
Yeah.
And it was Roger Stone Day.
Great reporting, great hunches. I'm glad it all worked out. Thanks, everyone. Stick around. Stone has been called the cockroach of American politics. He was even fired once from the Dole campaign because of a sleazy swinger ad. Take a look at Roger Stone's sordid and downright shady past next.
Here and now, under oath, were you at any time a member of a crime organization headed by Michael Corleone?
I don't know nothing about that. Oh. I was in the olive oil business with his father, but that was a long time ago, that's all.
That was the character Frank Pantangeli from the movie Godfather Part II, a one-time ally of Michael Corleone who cooperates with the FBI and then recants before that committee, claiming that the FBI told him to lie. Today we learned Roger Stone, President Trump's longtime confidant, has been charged with instructing a witness in the Mueller investigation to, quote, pull a Frank Pantangeli, which, as you see, means to lie. Stone's been a fixture in Republican politics for more than four decades, including a stint on the Trump campaign. But now his sleazy, take no prisoners approach might actually land him in the slammer.
I'm Roger Stone, R-O-G-E-R-S-T-O-N-E.
He's been called a dirty trickster, the prince of darkness, even the cockroach of American politics by the left-leaning New Republic. And Roger Stone flaunts many of these monikers as proudly as he flaunts his Nixon back tattoo.
I'm an agent provocateur.
Stone's reputation is hard-earned. His notorious political rap sheet goes back to the Nixon campaign when the then 19-year-old donated money to Nixon's opponent. He said it was from the Young Socialist Alliance and gave the receipt to the press. It didn't get any more ethical from there. In 1980, Stone began a lobbying firm with Paul Manafort that unapologetically catered to human rights abusers. Stone once boasted they, quote, lined up most of the dictators in the world that we could find. Pro-Western dictators, of course, the good ones. Nevertheless, the questionable consultant's resume is filled with work for Republican stars. Nixon, Reagan, Bush Sr., and of course,
I'm a political advisor to Donald Trump.
While working for Bob Dole, Stone's personal life caused a public stir. He was forced to resign from Dole's presidential campaign after a tabloid revealed that he and his wife had placed an ad for a sex partner in a paper called Local Swing Fever. But Stone did not go away. He continued to stir the political pot.
Fair trade agreement. So that
in 1999, Stone helped Donald Trump navigate his first short-lived campaign for the presidency.
I've got to give my best advice, but Mr. Trump makes the decisions. And frankly, the polls so far kind of reflect that voters like it.
A year later, in 2000, Stone took credit for disrupting the Florida recount by organizing a Republican riot at the Miami-Dade Elections Office. All the while, the Stone list of dirty tricks and black ops continued to grow. Stone took credit for the downfall of then-New York Governor Eliot Spitzer, saying he found out about Spitzer's penchant for prostitutes from a sex worker he met at a Miami swingers club.
Welcome to the Stone Zone.
Through his online channel, The Stone Zone, and national TV appearances, Stone has for years peddled countless deranged conspiracy theories.
I am not a conspiracy theorist. I'm a conspiracy realist.
And through all of this, there has been a mainstay, his longtime friend Donald Trump, who reportedly continued confiding in Stone even after firing him from his campaign in 2015. Stone claims he quit.
We go back a very long time. I have, Donald Trump came to my wedding. I went to two of his. I was at both his parents' funeral. I have great affection for Trump and the Trump family.
So what advice might the president have received? One passage from Stone's book of life lessons stands out. Quote, admit nothing, deny everything, launch counterattack.
So take a listen to Roger Stone today.
The only thing worse than being talked about is not being talked about.
The only thing worse than being talked about is not being talked about. He's being talked about because he was indicted.
Jake, he's looking like a mini Nixon there. The only thing he didn't say is, I am not a crook directly. And it's really not a good look. I mean, there have been 34 people charged, three companies, almost 100, you know. It's something wrong with this man. And it's something wrong with all of the president's men. It seems like that this entire, I mean, he has been, the president, I want people to wrap their minds around this. President Trump has been under some type of investigation ever since he took office.
Yep.
Imagine that.
So President Trump tweeted in December about Roger Stone, Kevin, take a listen to this, or take a look at this. I will never testify against Trump. That's President Trump quoting Stone. This statement was recently made by Roger Stone, essentially stating that he will not be forced by a rogue and out of control prosecutor to make up lies and stories about, quote, President Trump. Nice to know that some people still have, quote, guts. That does seem to be paramount to President Trump more than anything else. Loyalty to him.
Yeah, and he is the personification of the Trump approach to politics, too, right? Which is, forget it, it's not so much about ideas, but whatever you do, and Brian Stelter quoted this earlier, whatever you do, don't be boring, right? Mm-hmm. And that's Donald Trump's approach to politics. It's the same thing with Roger Stone. I think the bet here, it'll be interesting to see whether or not it's the right bet. The bet here that Roger Stone is making is that this can be won in the court of public opinion. The special counsel is making the bet that this is going to be won in the court of law and that ultimately is what will win the day. We're going to have to see that play out over the next few months.
I think Roger Stone is making the bet that he will be pardoned by Donald Trump.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
you think
exactly.
That's it?
That's it. And with public opinion from Donald Trump's base.
I say for the base. So yeah. And the indictment makes some incredible allegations against Stone. I should say they're not the allegations. There's evidence of them, including he threatened to kill the dog of person number two in the indictment, Randy Credico. He tells Credico, quote, you are a rat, a stoolie, you backstab your friends, run your mouth, my lawyers are dying to rip you to shreds, I am so ready, let's get it on, prepare to die. And then there's also some stuff about his dog. Let's show a picture of the dog because I just want to show it.
It's a sweet little dog.
Yeah.
And he complained about the FBI raid waking up his dog, so we know, if anything, that they're dog people.
I mean, the truth is no one's going to cry if Roger Stone goes to jail or when he goes to jail. But
he might like it.
But he might. Who knows? But the real question is given all of their history here between Trump and Roger Stone, is it actually plausible he didn't know what he was up to?
That's right.
What did Trump know? When did he know it? We don't know it yet, but I'm sure we'll learn it.
That's why the court of law is much bigger than the court of public
opinion. Can I also just say, like, it's pretty remarkable that the president of the United States has a close associate like Roger Stone. I mean, there are dirty tricksters in every party and every corner of politics, but this is a close friend of President Trump's, and this guy's awful.
Birds of a feather.
Has a Nixon tattoo.
Yeah,
that's Nixon a big red flag right there.
All right.
Well, I think that's unfair to Nixon, really.
Okay,
no, I just want to say.
All right, everyone stick around. Roger Stone was not even the only Trump associate in court today. That's next.